This, of course, is the second in our series over the 4 weeks, where we're going to take the opportunity presented by the lectionary to explore Paul's letter to the Philippians. During these 4 weeks, we'll be reading successively chapter 1, chapter 2, and so on, through the short letter to the Philippians. We talked a little bit about that as we started last week. There were some background notes available. I think they actually ran out during the 8 o'clock service. We didn't have enough out, but you can also access them on the cathedral website. You might like to do that just to get a little bit more background on the history of the city of Philippi, the foundation of the Christian community there by St. Paul, and the relationship that seems to have continued between Paul and that very young, fledgling Christian community there. As we saw last week, the bonds between Paul and the Philippians were so close, they were almost, in fact, visceral, and they certainly meant that people stuck with Paul and supported him through thick and thin. They supported him in prison, and as we saw, they sent one of their church members, Epaphroditus, to be his gopher, to be his personal assistant during the time that he was under arrest and in prison. In chapter 2 of the letter, Paul turns the focus more onto the internal life of this Christian community, and he's seeking to promote a sense of harmony among the members of the church. And we heard that right at the beginning of the passage from today. I'll just read a couple of sentences again. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, and that's, of course, the word compassion we looked at last week, make my joy complete, be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Notice that Paul is not saying, organize a vote. He doesn't actually say, send out a postal survey either. What he's saying to the congregation there in Philippi is to raise the bar much higher. They are to operate, in effect, by consensus. They're to seek total agreement between everybody in the community. That's hard enough to do in a family, impossible to do really in a nation, but it's a challenge that Paul sets before us as a church. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. That kind of unity is not achieved by voting, but by a willingness to listen, to understand, to put our own interests aside, and to put the interests of the other person first. That's not how our world works, as I'm sure you've noticed. It also wasn't how the Roman Empire worked. It didn't operate by consensus, that's for sure. The model for this kind of outlook, which Paul is recommending, requiring of his friends in Philippi, is not to be found in the way most people act most of the time, but simply in the example and in the person of Jesus. And so round about verse 5, Paul does that switch where he says, let this same mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. And in making that transition, we come to the crown jewels from this brief personal note sent by Paul to the Christians in Philippi in the northern winter, so in November, December, January, February of the years 54 and 55 in our era, of course. Paul backs up his appeal for the people to care for each other in that way and defer to each other in this way by quoting an early Christian hymn, something he knew that they were familiar with from their Sunday morning or Saturday night gatherings. And in doing that, as we read these lines where Paul is quoting ancient Christian hymn to them, where of course we're going back even earlier than the letter, and we're going back to an earlier phase. Possibly, we're actually hearing a song or reading the words of a song which Paul taught the Philippians when he was with them for a couple of weeks, founding their Christian community. More than that, we can presume that if this is a song that Paul taught them, and that's how he knows they will know it, it's probably a song that Paul was taught himself in the very early Christian community in Antioch, which you might remember is where Paul himself first became a Christian. So we're not just hearing Paul's letter to the Philippians, we're getting a snippet from the worship of the Christian community in the 30s and 40s, just 5 or 10 years after the crucifixion. So these words that we're going to focus on this morning, taking us back very, very close to the origins of Christianity. Interestingly, Paul doesn't ask people to believe a long list of things about Jesus, but to act in the same way that Jesus acted. Have this mind, have this attitude, have this outlook that Jesus himself had. That's a lesson, of course, the church soon forgot. We became quite skilled in assessing people on the basis of their beliefs, and to our shame, have even murdered each other because of differences in beliefs, disagreements of the doctrine. Paul appeals for Christians in Philippi to have the same mind, the same sense of themselves, the same outlook to others as we observe in Jesus himself. Here are the key lines again. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, and was born in human likeness. We could actually have a whole sermon series just on the Christ tip, as it's called, in Philippians chapter 2. But today we've got time maybe just to focus on two key ideas, and I think they're the key ideas that Paul wanted his friends to pick up. So let's look at two phrases, one longer than the other. First one is, he did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited. That's actually one of the most difficult sentences in the New Testament to translate, and translations have struggled with it over the years. It might be better translated as, he didn't understand equality with God as being about grasping. And the exploiting gets us close to that. To be God is not to be saying, give me, I want. To be godlike is to say, how can I help you today? We hold that idea in our minds for a moment. We'll recall that it fits well with what Jesus himself is remembered as saying about his mission in the Synoptic Gospels. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And that, of course, resonates as well with the scene in the Last Supper in John's Gospel, where Jesus doesn't simply take his place at the head of the table, but remember, takes off his outer garment, picks up a bowl of water, and kneels at the feet of the disciples, washing their feet. Divinity is not about power, but about service. That's not how we normally think about God, but it is the way Jesus teaches us to imagine God. More importantly, it's the way Jesus embodied God as love in action, not privilege demanding recognition. The God who comes among us in the person of Jesus is a God who serves, a God who heals, a God who saves, a God who restores, a God who unites. The other half of that phrase that in the Christ hymn is that rather than see divinity as being a matter of claiming things for himself, Jesus emptied himself. Emptied himself. He did not just understand divinity differently, he acted in a way that showed us a different side of God. The word that Paul is using there in his original letter, is a Greek word, kenosis, and that means to pour something out so that it is empty and has no value left. A very powerful word in our understanding of Jesus Christ. Far from grasping at privilege and power, Jesus gave it all away, poured it out. And we see that, of course, most powerfully in his death on the cross. No claims to privilege or status at Calvary. No demands for special treatment when you're nailed to a cross, but a willingness to pour out his very existence for the life of others. In an hour or so, we're going to be baptizing Theodore, the 11-month-old child, into our part of the amazing Christian movement that took root in Antioch and whose first European community was founded in Philippi by Paul about 20 years after Easter. As he grows up, there'll be things Theodore needs to learn, and there'll be some beliefs that he will come to embrace for himself as he grows into the faith that we'll be claiming for him this morning. We all have a stake in that process of faith formation, although, of course, the main responsibility rests with his parents, godparents. More important than any belief or any piece of knowledge that they will share with Theodore is the supreme importance of assisting him to have the same mind, as Paul would say, the same mind that we see in Jesus. As a follower of Jesus, Theodore will learn, we pray, to put others first, to pour out his life in the service of others. We wait to see just what form that will take in his particular life, just as we are each waiting to see how God's call takes shape in our own lives. But we give thanks for the gift that he will be, and indeed already is, to other people. And today we're asked to renew our pledge to spend our lives that way as well, to live for others, not for ourselves, to have the same mind in us that we see in the person of Jesus Christ. If we can live for others and not for ourselves, the world may yet be